you take your seats so we can begin the second part of the LACPS symposium on LACPS and the politics of community? We're really excited to have you all. I think most of you were here this morning, so I will only say that this is a Pacific Standard Time event. The symposium today is supported by our own Visions and Voices at USC, the larger show curated by Tim Ride, who's here and who directed the panel this morning with our wonderful LACPS artists, and David Evans. I don't think you were here this morning. We had Tim was lucky to have an assistant who actually was one of our students earlier on, David Evans. And let me tell you, if Tim Ride says the show would never have happened, then that's the dirty little secret. So thank you, David. I'm glad you're here. And don't forget to notice the little film in the reading room at Fisher when you look at the show, which has David's work and the voices of some of the artists on it. We now move into the second half of the panel, and if the first half of the panel was sort of referring to then, the second half of the panel, which will be moderated by our own Dean of the Roski School of Fine Arts, Rochelle Steiner, is about now. She's going to introduce everybody, but I get to introduce her, and that's my pleasure. Dr. Rochelle Steiner is Dean of the USC Roski School of Fine Arts and has been so for almost 2 years. Steiner is currently part of the curatorial team for the 2011 Shenzhen and Hong Kong Bi-City Biennial of Urbanism Architecture, working with USC faculty and students to develop 6 Under 60. I only mention that because not only is she doing all the administration work, she's also continuing her brilliant curatorial career. Rochelle is a noted museum and gallery curator, writer, and contemporary art leader. She directed the nonprofit Public Art Fund in New York from 2006 and did the amazing Waterfalls, which I think were all over the city in the water, of course, and was a notable accomplishment. Under her leadership, the organization commissioned 35 public art projects and did present that outdoor public space project, which I mentioned, which was Olafur Eliasson's The New York City Waterfalls. It was fabulous. And previously, Steiner served as the chief curator of the Serpentine Gallery in London and as associate curator of contemporary art at the St. Louis Art Museum, where she curated many exhibitions and is remembered very fondly by the people in St. Louis whom I met, many of whom I met with her introduction this last spring. Rochelle was consultant for the Miami Art Museum. She worked with the museum's trustees, directors, curators, and educators at a difficult time and helped them through that. In 2009, she was one of 10 fellows selected from museums across the country to participate in the Center for Curatorial Leadership, a program offered in association with the Columbia University Business School. Rochelle has a PhD in visual and cultural studies and an MA in comparative arts from the University of Rochester. She earned her BA in English and advertising from Syracuse University, and she's home now. So please welcome Rochelle Steiner.
Thank you very much, Selma, and thank you all for being here. It looks like the crowd is swelling as the day goes on, so that is great. I found this morning really fascinating, and we will continue now. For those who say there's no art community here in LA, I think that's obviously not true. We heard this morning, or earlier this afternoon, about LACPS and the way community was formed around photography in the 70s and 80s, and we're going to pick up now the discussion to talk about the way community continues to be formed. One of the things I thought was interesting earlier was the use of we. Everybody on the panel talked in the collective, and I suspect that's something that will continue on this afternoon in the discussion. We're going to take it, as Selma said, from then to now, and I think it's worth just thinking about the extent to which PST has allowed us and encouraged us to think about the then, and now it's really our opportunity to think about the now. One of the things I thought was remarkable this morning was putting, or this afternoon, I already think it was the morning, the way that LACPS coalesced at a time that was pre-MoCA, pre-LACMA, having a contemporary program, and the talk of the kind of DIY approach. And now, of course, there is LACMA and MOCA and lots of other things going on in the city, and I'll be interested to hear how everybody thinks of themselves, both in relation to that, as alternative to that, and to creating what will come to the future of Los Angeles and beyond. So a little bit about format. I've asked each of the panelists to give 15 minutes of presentation with slides, just to get a sense of the diversity of their practice. So we'll go one by one. At the end of the presentations, then we'll all gather on stage and have a group discussion, followed by Q&A. Now, I have the task of watching the clock. So when 15 minutes comes, I've already warned everyone they're going to get the gong, not because we don't want to continue to hear them talk, but because we do need to keep to time. So I apologize to them all in advance that if they go over, we will just stop and go on to the next person, and hopefully the points will continue to flow. So now I'm going to introduce our panelists. I'm very pleased to have with us Carol Stakenas, here in the front, who is the executive director of LACE, Los Angeles Contemporary Exhibitions. And since 1978, the organization has moved within and beyond their four walls to provide opportunities for diverse audiences to engage with contemporary art. Carol served as the lead curator for Los Angeles Goes Live, performance art in Southern California, 1970 to 1983, an exhibition and performance series as part of PST. Since her arrival at LACE in 2005, Carol has worked with over 500 artists, more than 60 of which have developed unique and innovative projects that could only be realized through a residency at LACE. And I have a feeling she'll talk about the importance of residencies on this city and on LACE. She was previously the deputy director and curator at Creative Time in New York, and she is an adjunct faculty member in Roski School's very own MA Art and Curatorial Practices program in the public sphere. Next, Anne Bray, here on the aisle, is an artist, teacher, founding director of Free Waves, which is a media arts organization and showcase of media arts, media art in art venues on the web, on TV, and on billboards, and on any other location Anne can co-opt. Free Waves is a grassroots yet global organization dedicated to collecting and connecting innovative and culturally relevant independent new media from around the world. Anne herself has exhibited artwork of her own in gas stations, malls, movie theaters, on TV, department stores, billboard, and other more traditional art venues. She's also an educator, and she too teaches in our Art and Curatorial Practices program, as well as at Claremont with the MFA program. Edgar Arceneaux, here on the aisle on the right, is an artist who received a BFA from Art Center College of Design in Pasadena, and an MFA from CalArts. He's from LA and has been here his whole development, minus a few residencies, including one at Art Pace in San Antonio, Skowhegan in Maine, and Project Row Houses. And I'll be interested to see how his experiences in Houston have affected his work now, which includes being director of Watts House Project, an artist-driven neighborhood redevelopment project centered around the historic Watts Towers. I had the privilege of going with Edgar to see some of the projects developing a couple years ago, and it was really great and fulfilling to see the way he was engaging with the neighborhood and his own commitment to the way art and life fit together. Edgar's received numerous awards, too many to list, and has been included in many big exhibitions, including the 2008 Whitney Biennial and the 2008 California Biennial. Mark Allen, in the front, is an artist, educator, curator based here in LA. He's founder and executive director of Machine Project, a nonprofit performance and installation space investigating art, technology, natural history, science, music, literature, and food in an informal storefront in Echo Park. Machine Project also operates as a loose confederacy of artists producing shows at locations ranging from beaches to museums to parking lots. Under his direction, Machine Project has produced shows with LACMA, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Denver, the Contemporary Art Museum in St. Louis, and the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis. He's taught at CalArts and at the University of California in San Diego, and he's currently associate professor of art at Pomona. I should mention that Mark received an MFA from CalArts and also spent some time in Houston in the core residency program there. Evelena Ruether is currently a student in our MA in Art and Curatorial Practice program. She has created with a partner an artist-run, project-based space called Control Room downtown. And this is a space for emerging artists. I'm really impressed by how Eve can run the space and take her degree at the same time, as well as coordinating programming for Outpost for Contemporary Art and The Big Draw here in LA with Ryman Arts, which is a not-for-profit organization that creates opportunities for high school kids around the city who are interested in art. Eve received a BFA from Art Center in 2009, and we're really excited to see where she's going to go following this program. She'll be finishing this year. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Carol, our first speaker. And one thing I will note is that in each person's biography, there is a dash, a slash, a multiple hat that is being worn, and I think that that is pretty indicative of the way the arts work, not only today in general, but here in LA. So over to Carol.
Surprisingly, though, when I was invited to become the director of LACE in 2005, they actually took the slash out of the title. Irene Tsatsos, who was the director before I was director slash curator, and for a variety of reasons, the board decided they really wanted to bring someone in as an ED to really focus on the organizational development as much as, you know, continuing to champion really adventurous programming. I certainly feel the slashes, though, implicitly. So, as Dr. Steiner mentioned, LACE was founded in 1978. This is our third official home, which is located on Hollywood Boulevard. We've actually been here since 1995-96, although many who might share their memories of LACE would do so when it was downtown on Industrial Street. And I think that that's one thing that I will be glad to bring to the conversation when we get to the Q&A is I'm the one presenter today who's not the founder of the organization, and it's been a real honor but also a real challenge to think about what the values are and how to continue to honor that legacy but at the same time be very responsive to the community and the issues of our time. So this, okay, things are a little bit messed up. It's okay. This is a reinvention of Gustave Courbet's The Artist Studio, and it was done on the occasion of LACE's 35th anniversary. We recognized, and for many of you, if you can dig back in your memory banks of that painting, it was created to communicate Gustave's conception of where he positioned himself within the world. So on the left-hand side of the painting was the everyday actions, himself and his muse in the middle, and on the right-hand side were his cohorts and his patrons. And I think that's become a really important thing to recognize in championing the kind of work that we're going to be looking at today with LACE and otherwise, is a real understanding of the importance and the primacy of artist-first thinking, but also that it does intersect and loop with the context of the time of our lives, and also with our stakeholders and the people that make sure that we can continue our path.
One of the first shows that I was involved in was called Draw a Line and Follow It, and it was an opportunity to invite artists to be in residency of a sort, where they got access to the Jean Brown Archive at the Getty Research Institute to look at fluxes. Performance scores. This is Felice Stella from the LA Art Girls, who created a piece called The Never Ending Dress. And I love to show it because, as a part of the opening, what she did is she started in the back of the space and had help with people unfurling her train. She was carrying a boombox playing bolero and then literally walked around the block and was able to re-enter the space and snap her dress back to her skirt, thus creating a very visible loop of the connection not only between moving through the space and through the art community, but out into the LA world proper. We've also worked with a number of artists, even before Pacific Standard Time, to invite them to re-vision and recreate early performance scores. This was also a part of Draw a Line called the Recut Series, where Ming Yuen Ma invited artists to redo Yoko Ono's cut piece. Amitis Motivali was one of the more unusual interpretations, where she decided language and a black permanent Sharpie marker was the tool that would be used instead of scissors to cut away pieces. The next series of slides actually talks about a project that LACE was involved in that wasn't exclusively centered at LACE, and that was Mark Tribe's Port Huron project. And the reason that I was interested in picking it was because when the project happened back in 2009, he had been commissioned by Creative Time as a part of a series that they were doing that to investigate artists looking at democracy. At the time, and he continues to teach at Brown University, where he had been a student, and was very confused and ambivalent about the fact that while our country had gone to war, there was really very little sign of student activism on campus. And so one of the things that he began to do was revisit a number of the New Left Democratic speeches that had inspired him as a younger person and do a series of reenactments around the country, including Cesar Chavez's speech at Exposition Park here near USC's campus called We Are Also Responsible. So LACE was a participant in helping stage the original, listen to that word, original re-performance, reenactment, that then became a part of a series of videos that were shown in all different formats, including in Times Square on one of the screens. Up in the very top right-hand corner, you can see the word reenactment, because part of what he was really doing is trying to reinsert the language of a time where young people were standing up and, providing leadership in protest. Ultimately, we did bring back the installation to our space in 2010, and ironically, much of his instinct was around how to create what I would call a multi-platform project, utilizing media and understanding media and citizen journalism, still very tied closely to filtering it back into the contemporary art world. But this piece would never exist now because of Occupy, because there is a very clear understanding and stake in how individuals of a variety of generations are coming together to comment on our society. Back to coming inside LACE, we were invited to be a part of the MoCA exhibition retrospective for Alan Capro. And again, he was named earlier in this seminar, and the work that he was doing, bringing together different individuals for these happenings. We invited Steve Roden, who is up there on the far left, to... For me, he was my Alan Capro, saying, please lead us into the archive. Let's figure out how to restage one of his first happenings. And what we ended up realizing was that we really needed to build a team to help kind of excavate and uncover how it is we would be able to bring this piece to life in contemporary context, which included the fact that when you're trying to reach back in time, there's so much about the context and the energy that is just no longer accessible. And yet we have our own time now and presence, and how do we utilize that respectfully to give people a sense of the vibrancy? And even in hearing the conversation earlier today, there is that continued tension. It was so amazing then. And we're here to say, it's really amazing now. Los Angeles Goes Live included additional commissions that were looking at performance. I am going to continue to look at a few more reenactments, including Leslie Starris Labowitz's Myths of Rape piece that she did in 1977 as one of several performances that happened as a part of Suzanne Lacy's 3 Weeks in May project. We've also heard about the rise of feminism and also feminist art practice. Leslie developed this piece with 8 other women that utilized the tropes of protest to walk through the mall part of City Hall, that underground mall, referencing the myths of rape. One of the other things that's important to notice is the woman in front with the materials, it looks like she can hand out, her face is wrapped in gauze. Everyone's faces were wrapped. Now, there's going to be a little whiplash here because this was the slide that I had been looking for earlier. But we're back to Myths of Rape, which we were invited to restage it as the part of the opening premiere party at the LA Art Show. This is like a fundamentally different opportunity than a daytime walk through a mall. But with that said, we thought it was a really compelling opportunity to bring the intervention. So both Leslie and Suzanne Lacy worked closely with 2 young artists, Audrey Chan and Alana Mann, to again reinvent Myths of Rape. Instead of 8 people, 8 women with their heads wrapped in gauze, which I thought was all a very aesthetic choice, turns out Leslie said they were terrified to be identified with stepping out and speaking about rape. Today, we had 30 intergenerational participants, both men, women, and even trans individuals, did not wrap their heads, did not feel that kind of fear. And the other thing that Alana and Audrey did to transform the piece was the placards had the myths on the outside, and then at certain points, the choreography was to open up to the facts. And you recognize some of the other references to street poster culture. In addition to the collective kind of en masse interventions, there were also moments throughout the fair where people would split off on their own and stage different tableaus, as it were. And now we start to see the rhetoric and the tropes of the Occupy movement moving into young artist performance. A human microphone, human mic tactic was used to call out the myths. As mentioned, this was a part of an overarching project that Suzanne Lacy had created in 1997 called 3 Weeks in May. So in January 2012, we did 3 Weeks in January and included the hanging of a map of Los Angeles in that City Hall Mall area. Every day, Suzanne and her collaborators would pick up the police reports from the day before and stamp the general location of the rape reports, as well as 9 additional halo stamps to recognize the unreported incidents. There were also consciousness-raising sessions both at the Women's Building as well as at other sites around the city. Self-defense workshops. There was an en masse self-defense workshop as the closing event at City Hall. And then there were also a team of women that not only helped put the stamps on the rape map for that visualization, but would also reintegrate the information back into the community with chalking. This piece was incredibly compelling to revisit, in large part because it anticipated something that is so much a part of our daily lives, which is this notion of data visualization and mobility of kind of information. One major distinction, however, is the first map was on this kind of breezeway in the City Hall Mall area. This time we were able to partner with Los Angeles Police Department to put the map on the LAPD. This is Monica Quijano, who gave us our stats. Another element that is very much responding to today's context was mounting a Twitter campaign as a part of mapping not only where rapes are happening, but who is being not only touched by the assault, but also who feels connected to it. So the retweet campaign said, "I know someone, do you, please retweet #rapeendshere." And this is an example of another kind of community visualization that began to build itself, not only within the art world, but also within the social service agencies that worked with us. A real highlight of the project was a what we call a critical conversation that happened at the top of Bradley Tower with a group of leaders, both in media as well as academia. And then to create a public event, we invited a series of social media bloggers and tweeters to actually capture the event and broadcast it out through the city. It's my turn to hand the mic over, but I did want to just take a moment to give a sense of one of the fundamental ways that LACE works today and has actually worked in this way for actually many decades, is recognizing the opportunity for intervention, for a certain kind of education. The picture I have for that happens to be of young people, which is awesome, although we all come together constantly to challenge our ideas, as well as bring a refreshed perspective to how it is that we as artists can both connect with our community of artists, but also beyond that.
Okay, over to Anne.
Hello, hi. So it's a nice segue to go from Carol to what I want to talk about. One is I worked at LACE from 82 to 89, and in the industrial section, and the artists were coming from all over the city to attend the free workshops, use the archive of video, and attend exhibitions, and we were trying to help artists all over the city to make their way through the video struggles at that time. And what it, all the artists didn't know each other. So we started like just trying to do communal events to help them make it through all the questions they were having. And that's what formed Free Waves. So come from this position here. This is a piece I did as a grad student at the end of my UCLA 1985 process, which is someone called the school and said, oh, you can make this billboard. And that was the only instructions. So I learned how to paint that month and did the upper billboard. And it appeared on Wilshire Boulevard. And I loved the placement of, you know, space left for us. To me, I was trying to put, you know, removing advertising from the public space, give viewers a moment of reprieve. And then the ad for the beer down below, it says, you can have it all. And to me, the juxtaposition of those two is exactly, you know, what I'm trying to do. There's one other I wanted to show. This was my final project in school, which is I whited out 500 signs at Lincoln and Broadway for one day with the permission of about 45 stores. And this thing of trying to create space in the city for art to exist in is really what I've been doing since I started, and want to just keep doing, and finding ways for artists of all kinds to get to do this, all ages, really trying to take themes that I think are important and put out open calls and find new curators and bring that variety of work out. That I do feel very hybrid as artists and nonprofit director, but what's the convergence for me is really as an artist, I find places where I feel like poignant intersections for a lot of artists can happen. So right now, I would love for a billboard space to be given over. These new electronic billboards, they have that 1% for art. Could that be applied to those billboards? And I think Los Angeles should definitely be leading in that area, not following. So here's free waves. How do we do this? And one is that I think as an artist, I don't feel like a large institution, right? I go with ideas that I have like an individual artist. The other is that as an organization, I'm really seeking resources around the city to collaborate with and pull off larger projects. So, for example, most of the larger institutions have enabled me to pull off things that I could not on my own. And this is, we took over the Hammer Art Museum, two floors of the lobby, which are, white walls up and downstairs, and we put out 50 projectors and showed a whole festival sort of simultaneously. There was a little sound issues, but and this is some other scenes of it. And I have, for maybe 10 years, I did that with MoCA. And then here's my effort working with LACMA and taking over the plaza with projection and for our 20th anniversary, putting out 20 different monitors, sort of showing one piece per year. And again, trying to have the flow of the city going up and down Wilshire Boulevard to have it visible. So a book and DVDs came out to record that history. And then even the Getty let me take over. And you think, oh, how'd you do that, Anne? And, you know what, I use humor a lot. I have to say that's my technique. And they willingly, I put in the proposal. It was sort of not their idea. I really wanted to use the idea of nature and culture that I thought that the Getty personified by having the gardens and then the art right side by side. And I felt like this issue of nature and culture, and that as we go digital, that is changing quite rapidly and new ideas are being able to come out. So I wanted to express where we were at that moment, and they allowed me to do 18 projections all the way from arriving on the tram out to the tip of the museum. And it was part of that California video show that they put on. And then, so now I'm at LACE again on Hollywood Boulevard. I've been there for about, I think, even 5 years already. And getting used to that boulevard, it's a very intense place that it changes hourly. And I noticed there were monitors everywhere up and down the street. So we took over about 50 stores and restaurants, and I wanted to deal with the theme of Hollywood, and the idea that people in LA know what that means, and people elsewhere in the world have no idea except for the stereotype. And so we really, a lot of deconstruction, a lot of other people's ideas, and we filled all these 50 stores with works from around the world. And that was the tattoo parlor. And it was that piece, Blue, the artist that got in trouble with Mocha. And tattoo, graffiti, connection, so that I had curators select the work, and then my job again was placing it, with like which would go into the, you know, the restaurant, and which would go into the taco place. Yeah. So here's one, the Hollywood bookstore, with the one called, that had all endings of Hollywood films. This beautiful Turkish animation at the yogurt store. And tours. So this was and all these people coming to Hollywood to be in the movies. And our argument was, well, there's so many surveillance cameras up and down that street that you are in the movies. It's not the movie maybe you want. So we, this is McDonald's. And we gave a tour that ended in McDonald's. And they have surveillance everywhere in that restaurant, and quote unquote restaurant, and it's filled with Hollywood, you know, reels and movie star imagery, and we just really got down to these issues of surveillance in there. So we're walking tours and bike rides and eating while showing videos. Time-wise, okay. Okay, and then GLOW over in Santa Monica every couple of years. So this is the Holiday Inn. A seven-story hotel with the wall that's facing Santa Monica Pier, and worked with a group of artists, mostly commercial artists, and we had 10 banks of computers and, you know, a phenomenal amount of equipment to actually pull off a seven-story live video mixing and music performance that I would love to do again with a larger budget. Now I know how to technically do it. Let's artistically do it. All right. And then to me, one of the big changes that came along is that I mentioned the founding of Freeways was all these people getting together, and to me the web came along, and it really answered so many of the issues that I was trying to do, which was get people together, exchange, help, assist, show. And so we have, since the web was formed, we've really been putting up video as much as possible, showing work, bios, putting out artists' email, where to reach them, who's making what kind of work. And this is a page from our Hollywood Festival, and we have an archive at freeways.org of 500 videos by artists. And then this is the final project I wanted to talk about, which for the last year I've been working on the city buses. LA Metro has 2,000 buses with two TVs per bus and not a very good sound system. So we've been really making visual pieces that are in the one-hour loop that they play every hour all day long that the buses are running. And that it's been a really exciting project for me. One, we were able to really commission works, and the commissioned ones are definitely the one that worked great. That the artists with the these problems of no sound, a small screen, you know, an audience that may not be paying so much attention, that is so diverse. It's really, it covers all 4,000 square miles of this county. But how we worked on it is, one, we surveyed 500 riders before we started. Two, we, after each video, we asked a question, sort of an open-ended question about the video, and any writer could text us or email us back with their answers. And it's really sort of informing me, and then I can then help to choose the next work. We can rebuild up that interactive system and put out replies to people and get more replies. So I feel like the trend that I've really worked on is this thing of interacting with the audience and creating network, and that the change over these years has been that maybe everyone can be included in this process of art making, art viewing, curating. We make playlists now of responding to the artists, asking questions, that all of it is a large dialogue. And that I want to propose the idea of art being everywhere.
Okay, Edgar's next. Thank you, Anne. Let me just get to Edgar.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Thank you for taking your Saturday to hear us all speak about our work. And I really appreciated what you said. Yeah, I've known you for a while, but I had no idea all the various things that you've done and what you've been up to, so that's really special. And also for you, Carol, as well. So, and I'm looking to learn more from my other my peers, and also from our conversation. I'm Edgar Arceneaux, and I'm executive director of Watts House Project, which we describe as an artist-driven neighborhood redevelopment organization. At the heart of it, this is what we do. We are artists, architects, and residents that work together to try to bring about improvements to the neighborhood that surrounds the Watts Towers. Renovation projects are brought about by artists and architects being teamed with a family to bring some sort of transformation to their home. That can be interior renovations, new bathroom, new kitchen, or exterior work, new fences and driveways. And the idea there is to do a combination of both aesthetic improvements as well as quality of life improvements. Because as soon as you start to work inside the home, you also build equity into the home, and that allows for it to become a sort of passive kind of engine, which can enable the family to have assets to be able to grow in the future. Community organizing, programming, and training, an artist in residency program. We have a local artist from Watts that's working with us on a project. And our residential housing piece is one of our dreams, which is why it's in gray. And the goal there is to help to work with families in the neighborhood whom are renters to be able to transition them towards home ownership. And then that way they can become part of our renovation program too. But really what's at the heart of it, this is a new graphic for me, this little explosive star. You guys have to tell me later if it's working or not. But really at the heart of all of these things that we do is trying to build this process of como cimiento, which is a term from Latin America, which is about the process of building rapport with someone that you don't know, which can then lead to trust, which can lead to co-powerment or some kind of shared activity. And for us, that shared activity results in some kind of physical transformation to a space, either that be a driveway, a fence, or some sort of work upon the home. But, you know, I'm sort of going to pause for a second because before we sort of started this process today, I got a text message from one of the families that we work with, Genaro and Rosario Alvarez, whose cousin is 5 years old, and he had a congenital heart problem. Something happened, and he had lost oxygen to his brain, and he's been in the hospital in a coma for about a half a year now. And yesterday he called me to tell me that they were going to the hospital because I think they're going to turn off life support. And he just sent me a picture of it, of Mario, and he just texted it to me about 20 minutes ago. And I'm trying to figure out, okay, well, how do I stay focused on this presentation? But, you know, in a lot of ways, you know, what it does is that it touches on the thing that we all want, that these are the qualities that we try to aspire towards or to build. I mean, these are the things which we call community, that space of security, that space of friends who were once strangers, or friends becoming family in which you can share within something which is so tremendous as a loss like this. And it reminded me of a few weeks ago that I was in an airport, and I was waiting for my flight, which I had actually missed. And there was a woman sitting there looking at her phone, and she just started sobbing. And I was standing there, and I was looking at her, and I was thinking to myself, wow, what am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to ignore this? I mean, clearly she's going through some very intense emotional pain. And I look around everybody in the airport, and I know they see her too, but when I look at them, they look away from me. And when I look at her, when she looks at me, then I look down. And I'm like, oh man, what is this? When someone is in that much pain, I mean, it seems like the least that we can do is just to let them know that we recognize that they're suffering somehow. And it's somewhere within that space of commonality, which maybe there's the opportunity for that expression called love to emerge. This process of como cimiento, of being a stranger to a family and going through the process of building rapport and building trust and then collectively trying to build something together, at the heart of it is what community building is about. Because in that regards, no matter how many coats of paint you put on or how many bricks you put in a wall, if the nature of the personal relationships that happen outside of the house have not changed, then it doesn't really matter what you do to the exterior of the home or even the interior. So we're based in a community. This is Watts. This is sort of the heart of it. That's the Watts Towers. And as some of you know, Watts burned in 1965, and it has a very tumultuous political history. Up until 1965, it was a predominantly African-American community, but pretty soon after 1965, a lot of blacks started to move out of there, and the Spanish-speaking population really started to take its place. So when I first got involved with Watts House back in 1996, this neighborhood, our redevelopment zone, was 50% African-American, and now there's two black families on the block, and only one of them are owners. And I don't speak any Spanish, just so you know. I mean, un poquito, like that's about the extent of it. But we're able, over these years, just through consistency and staying there and sort of speaking through that kind of common language of problem solving and creativity and design, been able to build some very long-lasting relationships. How are we doing time-wise? Can you tell me how many minutes I have? Thank you. So I thought that I would show you some of the projects that we're doing, which speaks to the physical transformations, but also what I would like to speak to is the human part of it, that human connection that really grounds it all. So Felix Madrigal is here, there on the bottom left, and the project, Watts House Project, began in 1996, but we didn't really start doing any work on the ground until 1999. And the very first project we did was a driveway with Felix that you can hardly see, but it's over on the right. And Felix's problem was that he had an unpaved driveway, and he would get close to $1,000 in parking tickets for parking in front of his own home. He had the idea of doing a driveway. We designed it together, and working with friends of his, we were able to do it at a third of the cost and a third of the time. And then we had some carne asada afterwards and some beer. It was very nice. And that really laid the foundation for WHP, which is that the aesthetics of what we do should really grow pragmatically from the necessities of the place. And that driveway really laid the foundation for WHP, because after 2003, I didn't have any money, nobody would give us anything, and every time I would go and visit, Felix would say, "Hey Edgar, when are we going to do another project?" I said, "Felix, I'm trying, you know, I'm trying to figure it out." 2004, "Felix, how's it going, you know, hey, when are you going to do the project?" "Oh, I don't know, Felix, I'm trying." 2006, "When are we going to start the project, Edgar?" I was like, "I don't know." He's like, "Well, would you hurry up?" So in 2008, when I was in the Whitney Biennial, I figured that was a good time to try to restart it again. And that's when we had the idea to turn it into an organization as opposed to an art project. So these are some of our designers. Stephen Slaughter on the left, Amy Devers from the DIY Network is sitting there, Tanya Guianega, who I believe teaches at USC, or taught at USC, maybe I'm wrong. And this is the space that we own, the platform. We purchased these properties back in 2009 through a generous loan from Jeffrey and Catherine Soros. We were able to get these three homes for $120,000. When we originally conceived of this space, and I called it the platform, we imagined that it would be kind of a community hub where we can do all sorts of programming that would be really responsive to the needs of this neighborhood. But what happened 2 weeks ago is that I got two phone calls that kind of really changed the way in which I think about what it is that we do here. One is that Jose, the brother of Hanaro and Rosario, and actually is his cousin as well, who's in the hospital, called to tell me that the landlord had sold his property and that they were gonna forcefully evict him from his home in 20 days. So I'm in Sonoma, I don't really know what to do. So I'm trying to figure out how to remedy the problem. Two nights later, I get a text message from my wife at 4 o'clock in the morning saying, "Some man is beating on the door, we don't know what to do, I'm all home alone." She calls the police come. I call my brother, I'm like, "Hey, I really need your help. Can you come and sleep on the couch? Can you do something just so I can feel better?" He's like, "I'm there, dude, I'm there." So that night, he was there for me. And I realized that even though we were focusing on art and housing with WHP, that we really weren't doing anything if we allowed for a family who'd been there for 25 years to lose their home. So I'm proud to say that recently the board decided that we actually are going to convert these back into residential housing, and that if indeed we can't keep these families in their home, this will be a space for them. This is work from the School of Architecture at USC that you're seeing here. And the idea was that the front of the platform would be a communal meeting space. This is what it looks like today, and this is the plans for it that we're looking for in 2012. So I'm going to end here because I don't want to go over time, but basically what we try to do is to leverage unique partnerships with local skill sets, with folks in the neighborhood to try to find mutual benefit. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Edgar. I'm just going through a few images to get to Mark. Who is next? Mark.
Great, thanks for coming out. I sometimes feel like I socialize with my colleagues by being on panels with them, so it's nice to see you guys and hear what you've been up to. Something which I think has already come out in this panel, and I'm sure will come out of the discussion, is the way in which we're at a moment in our cultural history where art has become this container for intersecting an incredibly wide range of ideas and philosophies and social practices. And so when I started Machine Project, I was kind of thinking about this idea and thinking about the way a physical space could be a machine for generating ideas of thinking about the world. That you could take an environment and feed in philosophers and artists and practices, and out of that generate new ways of kind of thinking about human existence. So I rented this storefront in Echo Park in 2003, and just started using it for whatever seemed interesting. Thinking about different kinds of communities of interest could come together, that we might have a scientific talk one day, a poetry reading another day, community workshop the day after that. And then there was something about a storefront space which was particularly porous to the outside world, that we would have this front window and whoever was walking by from the neighborhood or driving by in Alvarado could kind of see what was going on the inside. And at this space, we really focus on projects which are experiential, projects which are participatory, projects which might be performative. And in general, like, the idea of people doing things together is kind of the core principle of the projects we do. And so sometimes that means work which we think of as social practice or participatory work. This is a piece by Liz Glynn, where over the course of 24 hours, participants remade the architectural history of Rome, and then at the end of those 24 hours, became the invading Visigoths and destroyed the city. But it also means exploring the way that audience has a relationship to artists. So not just that the audience has to be literally participating in the manufacture of the artwork, but that the space between the audience and the artist is kind of a place you can play with. So for this example, we had two poets in the basement, and you could put a suggestion for a poem through a hole in the floor, and they would read a poem to you through this funnel. And that you would have an opening going on with everybody sort of talking to each other, and then one person at a time having this direct aesthetic experience with the artist. And so with these kinds of projects, the event becomes this moment where the artwork is completed. So it's not like where you're making a piece in the studio and you can complete it before it happens. It's more that the art space or cultural center becomes an extension of the artist project. So there's the space, there's the artist, and there's the public. And something that I've found really interesting about audience is it's this variable which is continually changing. You do a project in another location, you do a project in another cultural time, you do a project in different contexts, and it really changes the meaning of the work. And so this puts the presenting organization in this place of not having an idea of whether something is going to be successful in a conventional sense or not until it happens or until it's over. And I'm increasingly thinking that this is one of the really important roles of alternative spaces in the art economy, to be a place in our culture where projects can happen before they've sort of demonstrated that they're successful in some kind of conventional sense. And from working in, I've done a lot of projects with museums in the last two or three years, and I always enjoy doing that, but I've really become convinced that contemporary art museums should be called museums for stuff which very recently happened that everybody has decided is really good, rather than things which are about to happen or things which are happening. And so my strategy for dealing with this uncertainty about the results of what would happen is to kind of push aside success as a modality for thinking at all and trying to move to a modality of thought which is about experimentation. So that each project you do is part of a process or part of a flow of research that you're doing with the public. Sometimes this idea of flow happens in a very material sense, where projects from one activity might show up in the next. So we did a project where we turned the gallery into a forest with Sarah New and Christy McCaffrey, and then afterwards had a whole gallery full of trash left over, which was kind of depressing. And so Liz Glenn and Nate Page did this thing where they turned the remnants of that show into art objects, which the audience could take home. So this is like a handbag made from the remnants here. With the understanding that you wouldn't be allowed to throw stuff away. Yes, Edgar. They were a mix of like real trees and prop trees, and depends which one you're pointing at. The big ones are prop trees. I know a great prop tree house if you're looking. Yeah. So there's this material sense of process, but it's more often that the ideas that are generated by one project lead to the next. So we had done a project where, we teach a lot of classes, and we teach sewing, and we teach electronics, and we kind of got tired of the way that it was all women taking sewing after a while and all men taking electronics. And so we designed a class which combined the two, where you had made things out of, you made these sort of soft sculptures out of felt, and then you would design sound circuits that went into them. So like this calculator, you plug it in, it makes bleepy bloopy noises. And one of the things that we realized from that was that like a hands-on workshop was a really interesting way to bring different audiences or communities together. And so for a recent project at the Berkeley Art Museum, we did a project called the Machine Project Confusatron. And the way it worked is we had simultaneous workshops in kimchi making, plant cloning, turning cactuses into electronic musical instruments, and something called tranimal makeovers. Tranimals, it's an interpretation of drag, which is very influenced by Leah Bowery, and it kind of is interested in the space between like the human and the non-human as much as about gender. And so the idea is that you would come, you would make some pickles, you might get a really intense makeover, and then you would go and learn about soldering. And so thinking about then the event becomes this space to not only bring like different audiences together, but also to produce an exploration about what does knowledge work mean? What does it mean to juxtapose a form of knowledge we might think of as really functionalized, like electronics, with something that might seem less practical, like doing this kind of makeover. And so kind of working with these models, I decided to make a chart, and I use this chart a lot to think about how events work. And so on the vertical axis, you have the audience's response to an event. And on the horizontal axis, you have this idea of, is the knowledge produced, is that something new, or is it something familiar that we've kind of seen before? And I feel like I really think it's important for those of us who are cultural producers to realize you kind of are going to end up hitting the whole map. That it's, you know, like everybody wants to be both enjoyable and new, and that's great, but I think there's also a real space for doing things which are also traditional. So we think about, like, we do sing-alongs every 4th of July and other holidays, and we do these jam-making events where it's a very traditional way of building community and a traditional way of transferring knowledge, but this is an important way to do these things. And then also, if you're not ending up in one of the vexing or tired spots, then you're really not pushing to try and do new kinds of ideas. And increasingly, the way that I think about audience and community is that if you're going to be doing these things which are awkward or don't work or new, it's very important that the audience is part of that process. That it's not so much that they show up once to kind of consume your cultural product, but more that they are coming regularly and understand that they are as much about that process of developing new ideas as anybody else has. So that's my little talk. So I'll pass it on.
Okay, I'm going to turn it over to Eve.
Hi. I really want to thank Dean Steiner for inviting me to be a part of today's discussion. I'm going to talk about Control Room, which I started with a partner about 2 years ago. It's a commercial storefront space downtown that we had for a while, and basically the premise of what allows us to have the space is that there's a living area in the back that my partner William Kaminsky pays rent for as living space, and then there's some space in the middle that is a studio space that I contribute rent to, and that allows us to have the space with absolutely no funding and low overhead. So we're paying rent to have the space, and we can kind of do whatever we want there without having to answer to anyone. This was our inaugural show. We opened in New Year's 2010, started shortly after graduating from Art Center undergrad, and we were looking around at the different scenes in Chinatown or Culver City and not really feeling comfortable with trying to insert ourselves into that or waiting around for when our time would come to show the artists that were around us that we thought were really strong, and we wanted to support our peers, and so we thought we'll just do it ourselves. So we started the space. One of the things that is really important to us is to move beyond. There was this idea that I don't think might not be so true now, but that an artist-run space is kind of shoddy or not so clear, but we wanted to have a really be able to present work as strongly as we could and really clear, and we do a lot of work to make sure the space is always presenting work the best way that we can. And this project was LA News. It was a project by William Kaminsky, actually, that was for 6 days. We had a room that was built out inside the gallery so that it was completely sealed off, and we removed the doors entirely. So for the whole week, the space was open 24 hours a day to anyone on the street that would enter the space and kind of use the broadcast however they wished. So this was a large projection that was on the roof, and then there was also a live video feed 24 hours a day on that was on our website. So this is kind of to see, we were initially concerned, you know, about vandalism and really not knowing what would happen. We're downtown on 7th Street in a really industrial area of the city, and there's, you know, homeless, and we thought they, you know, might come in and try to live in the space, which, you know, we were kind of open to those possibilities. But we didn't know what to expect, and we learned a lot about the respective boundaries that happen. So different things happened throughout that week. Some friends, you know, that knew about the project came and did kind of art performance things, and then other people just came in off the street. And then one of the interesting things is that there's a bar right across the street, and so when it would let out, it would let out at 2 o'clock in the morning, and that was kind of the busiest time because of the projection on the roof. It was like this beacon or spectacle, and they're like, what's going on across the street? A band came in and played. Some political debates happened. I don't know where people come from. But then again, towards the end, we started to reach these other kind of audience, and really interesting discussions happened. But there's this really practical thing where, because it was 24 hours, somebody had to be awake. So William was basically awake in the space 24 hours a day for that whole week, unless somebody gave him breaks. So it wasn't really possible to keep it going, but it was interesting to see how the space changed, and it became a platform that people thought that they could actually use over time. Yeah, so there's like hundreds and hundreds of photos of all the different kind of people that came in, and like all the footage from the recording. So a lot of times too, it was just empty, and so it's recording, like what the live feed is just like the desk. It was this tiny little room with a camera and just a table in the LA News, but then it became kind of activated at different times. And then we curated this group show, Beaten Off. It was about the LA landscape. We curated it with two other artists. So as a group, we curated it. And at the end of the show, we did a talk with Jan Tumler. And he actually was able to use the context to test out ideas, too. So his talk that happened at USC was actually development from the talk he had done here, which, so it was really exciting. He's kind of a mentor of ours that we worked with at Art Center, and you know, a figure in LA, and so to see him being able to test out materials in this kind of space was great too. And then we had a group discussion that went really well because, of course, everyone living and working in LA has some perspective and wants to be in that conversation. So doing that kind of panel discussion in that space was new for us and exciting too. So 7 Minutes in Heaven was another show, and like I said, how we started the space when we came out of undergrad, but then since then many of the artists have branched out into different grad schools in Southern California. So we thought, I came into USC and William started at UCLA, and we felt like we're in this unique position to be a bridge between all these different art schools that could sometimes be more isolated. So Karen Edelman is at USC, Andrew Cameron wasn't at the time, but he's now an Art Center undergrad, Chris Coy is at USC, Valerie Green is at CalArts, Masood Kamandi is at UCLA, Ryan Perez is at UC Riverside, and so this show was able to bring together each artist brought their community with them, and then so in the space of the show and the opening, all of these different communities came together, and I believe like started some really great relationships just from being included all in the one show. And you can see we're always kind of working on the space. Before there was just kind of a curtain over on the left, but we're always trying to do what we can to make the space present the work the best way we can do it, even though we have, like I said, no funding at all. We just don't let that stand in our way of trying to do the best that we can with the space. It All Ends was a show with Michael Kelly and Jared Clark, and we kind of piggybacked on a show that was curated by Nicole Hebron at Gencar in Chinatown, and she was bringing a bunch of artists from Salt Lake City, Utah, to Los Angeles for a show there. And so Michael and Jared both are from Salt Lake. Michael is at UCLA now, and then Jared is based in Salt Lake City. And we wanted to take advantage of the fact that this other scene would be present in LA the same weekend. And so they all came into the space, and again, we started building relationships with artists that were working in Salt Lake and came, and Gencar even did a, there was a talk at LACE for the show that was talking about what it means to be working in this other city outside of LA and what it meant for them to come here. And then this is also when the gallery starts to begin to expand into the back of the space. So the longer we went on and the more work that happens, we keep like the art keeps infiltrating into the back and starts to really frame the events and what happens there. These are rocks on one side that are painted to look like the objects on the other side. The show is really fun and had a lot of humor and great stuff behind it. This is was Surprise Issues Period Party. This is our flyer folded up into one of those little fortune things. It was built around the screening of a video by Kim Kelly and Dylan Mira, which is like this video episode about a teenage girl, and it's kind of grotesque but really funny. And we needed to wanted to find a way to how to screen this video and also expand into the space and what other kinds of activities would surround the video to for this event of screening it. So there's like a bucket there that was bobbing for beats, which only the artist really did, and then that's a zip pinata. This is a cave and a bowl. There's a bowl of hot dogs, and you would toss hot dogs into the cave. This is a coconut bra with water balloons that you would shoot. And so that was kind of like everybody loved that because it was actually really hard to hit it, and everyone was very determined that they would pop one. And they didn't really pop either, they just kind of came this fountain. This is a frying station where we're frying all kinds of different foods and then also frying tampons. That was just the people that were attending the event. Those weren't like the artists that were shooting. Everyone could like shoot the gun, and so that was very. here's the crashing of the zit pinata, and then so we really like to. This show was really about the collaboration that happened with the artists, and it led to this really beautiful moment of total chaos where, the pinata had Cheetos and glitter in it, and it's really exciting for us to provide a space where, you know, this can happen, and I don't see it happening in a lot of spaces necessarily, and if the work demands it, where just let the artist take over control and have the authority of to use the space how they want to. So CoLab was a kind of unprecedented organization of all the artist-run and nonprofit and independent spaces in LA all had one floor of the art platform, art fair. And so though it seems kind of like we're all the kinds of spaces that should be responding like hypercritically to the context of an art fair, the since we were all in it together and we all kind of had our own spaces which were donated, you know, there's the commercial gallery level upstairs and then in the entire basement where we all had, you know, kind of booths. The approach was more to use the space as we would our own and just go and just show strong work, and the difference between what was going on upstairs and downstairs would be self-evident, and I think it really was. The spaces were just activated very differently, and the response was really great. There's Jell-O underneath, and we also served Jell-O shots for one of the days at the fair. I'm going to move kind of quickly through a couple of these shows. This was a show, Lean On Me, by two artists, David Bell and Noah Spindler, who were an undergrad at UCLA, and they conceived the show specifically for our space. There was a performance by a sound group, Sun Energy Sound, at the closing, and that's Noah jumping through the hoop. This is the Reality Institute, which is this ongoing project by Mike Molicho, and their slogan is determining what's real so you don't have to. So it's kind of a fake institution that only exists online and in writing. Mike Molicho is a writer, so that was a whole new group. He's in the writing program at CalArts. And it basically created all these living environments in which to present different videos and things. And then there were a bunch of readings also. That's him eating his holograms cereal, which is like the styrofoam packing things. And then their last show was artists from Norway, and so they got funding from the Norwegian government to come have a show, and so 7 of the 9 artists in the show traveled to LA, and it was really exciting for us to have this exchange on this international level, which, you know, often only happens at a certain kind of level of institutional support, and so having that happen at the space level of the artist-run space, I think, is really exciting. And I'll just come to the end here. And this is the show we have up now. It just opened last night. It was curated by Kevin Hanley. And again, this group of artists is a little bit more established and of a different kind of generation or echelon than the emerging artists. And I think we really like to get rid of the lines that are so often drawn between like artist-run space and what belongs in that space and what kind of potential an artist-run space can have to reach beyond that. Just like the international exchange, like these more established artists, we're really excited to have something at a very different kind of context than I think they're all used to. Thank you so much.
Okay, so I'd like to invite everyone from this panel to come up, and we'll start a discussion and for a little bit, and then we'll open it up. Edgar, you need your glasses, maybe. Those are Edgar's.
Really?
That's Mark.
Oh, last night?
I wanted to be you for a minute.
What?
Edgar.
Pass these to Edgar.
Okay, so maybe just to start, Carol started off by saying it was amazing then and it's amazing now, and I think this gives a good sense of the incredible range of activity that's going on in LA, and this of course is just a small piece. But I wanted to start by talking about the idea of being invited to do things and making a space for yourself. And you talked about taking over the plaza, the street, the museum, kind of infiltrating the city. Others have talked about leaving a space open, Eve, leaving a space open for people to kind of take over and do what's going to happen. At the same time, there are people here inviting others to do things. Can you reflect a little bit on this kind of push-pull between the invitation and the DIY?
who wants to start?
I would love to just jump in. And can you hear me?
I think it's on. Is that?
Hello.
It's not on. First is not on.
Okay. Okay. Hi. To me, it's what I was thinking about in general today was this thing of working with institutions and working outside of them, and of whether we could create more and more different forms of collaboration to allow people with radical ideas and working within the city. And feeling like a wide spectrum that we all represented here, from permanent things down to just 1 hour long, and the extreme of the difficulty, like, are you really trying to present something very warm, fuzzy, nice, that is very fundable, or are you really trying to put forward a new difficult idea that is testing people? And I think that's the range that you'll end up with because of that, challenge or no challenge.
The invitation, it's kind of like an invitation to, how would I describe it, to not to invade, but basically with socially engaged projects, I mean, they're putting you into a position in which you then have to go to other people and say, hey, you don't know me, but I got this idea. Do you want to do this with me? And it's kind of about in kind of stepping, at least in Watts House Project sense, about kind of stepping into other people's spaces in which you may not necessarily be welcome. But it's through a certain kind of honesty and openness that you hope that you can build a relationship that can then lead to something that perhaps that neither one of you can do on your own. So when Watts House Project first started out, it was part of an exhibition at MoCA that was called Uncommon Sense that opened up in 1997. And the founder of Watts House Project as an art project was Rick Lowe. And he was looking all over the city of places in which this activity could take place, but the only one that showed any real interest was the Watts Towers Art Center. And that was underneath the directorship of Mark Greenfield. Let's just say that invitation to be there is not exactly extended by the new leadership of the organization. So of the Watts Towers Art Center now. But I think that there's a sort of a combination of both invitation and then an expectation that you're going to produce some sort of tension if you're trying to indeed produce some kind of change within that space.
Sure, and actually one of the things that I realized and appreciated as I was getting a chance to see a lot of the projects selected, one that I wanted to share with you all is a painting exhibition LACE actually had last summer called Unfinished, where we had two guest curators who proposed to us an exhibition that would feature, I think at this point, close to 150 paintings by individuals who deemed them incomplete or unresolved. And it was a really exciting moment because of being able to open up an idea of invitation into our space, and that it challenged the notion that the way you would do so is by taking on the forms and tropes of a social practice or a media-based art form or performance, which we really deeply love, but that in fact there are also other kind of areas of inquiry as well. So I think that's one of the things that we have found to be extremely important to take seriously, that notion of invitation, and strategically challenge ourselves to think differently about where and how that the space can be opened.
The question is about inviting and being invited?
Yeah, I think especially probably with your work.
Yeah.
You ride the line between doing it
testing it, having things kind of emerge and evolve on the street and the storefront, and right. then this oddity of being invited by a museum to kind of recreate a situation or create one anew. And I would imagine that your approach to the first is somewhat different to your approach to the second, or at least there's some negotiation that needs to happen there.
Right. Well, I think there's a couple of factors at play in kind of contemporary practice which lead to a lot of this. One is like an increasing understanding of the importance and power by artists of context creation. So that when you go to art school, you learn a lot about how to make stuff, but really the meaning of that stuff you make is dependent on where it actually goes. And so I think many or most young artists are interested in how do they make both the stuff and the context of the stuff. So like we just heard of 14 awesome shows in like 3 minutes. That's very much like people just graduated from school and are making a context for their work to be seen. So I think that practice is happening a lot. I think the other thing is that if you're working either adjacent or in opposition to or around more kinds of commercial practices, the economic or cultural capital aggregation process of individual authorship becomes less important, and you can invite more and more and more people in without diluting the kind of value of what you're doing.
Can you say that again?
I highly doubt it. But what I'm saying, is that an art market circulates on the power of scarcity, and an alternative practice operates on the power of abundance. And the way I would say that is that if I'm invited by Ann Philbin to be in residence at the Hammer, I then invite Nate Page, who's an artist I work with, to think of a project for it. He decides to invite his grandfather, who was a sign painter in Milwaukee his whole life. And the project is his grandfather is going to teach everyone who comes to the museums to paint the signs for the museum. So the authorship of that piece just got spread out like it got hit by a comet, right? What happens if you're comfortable with that or you think that's interesting, which I do, like meta curation, you then extend the cultural production to an extremely diverse or wide range of people. And I think that that becomes a very interesting way to work, which leads you to both acting like a host and also acting like a virus. And so I think that we kind of go back and forth between those two things.
It does highlight one of the fundamental kind of qualities that shapes this kind of work, which is that it should be understood as it's emerging over time. So there's the accumulations shouldn't be referred to just simply on their own, though they do have their own merits, but it's about understanding how it's part of an ongoing emergent property. And then, like, that's sort of where the poetics comes from. So when I was looking at your presentation, I was thinking, damn, you know, there's bricks in the walls, and now the next slide is somebody stuck some 2x4s through the wall. And now somebody busted a pinata open, and then, you know, I don't know what they're pulling in. But, you know, like, each one of these things is happening in the same space, so I must sort of contend with it in its sort of ever-emerging quality. And I think with each one of our projects, it changes because of the nature of the context and whom our participants are. But I would say that, you know, part of that thing that you're saying, I think of it as a comet hitting and blowing stuff. I mean, that tends to destroy entire civilizations, comets hitting stuff. But, you know, maybe something more like that star that I had in my PowerPoint presentation. That was a little more.
I pass the mic to the power of my colleagues' PowerPoint graphics.
Carol.
I just wanted to add one more thing, because, and again, I think I'm pushing the conversation maybe in a slightly different direction, but one of the challenges is that while the structure that is offered in the way that you work, I feel like as an art world, it's still telling a story that they can't hear yet. in large part because, yet again, who has been invited to speak today? Very particular group of individuals, including myself. I'm representing ultimately, 5,000 artists who have probably brought in lots more. We did a project where we were asking different artists and their projects to speak as a part of an alliance we did with Suzanne Lacey's course at LACE, and invited Watts House Project. And at the time, Edgar and Sue Bellion said, "Well, can we bring a member of our community with us?" And what was really compelling but also deeply stressful was that, and you mentioned it from the other side, you don't speak Spanish. Here was an individual who was an absolute stakeholder in the transformation of this project. And he was there and excited and interested to participate. But afterwards, when I said, "It really means a lot that you took time to come and be with us here in Hollywood," he said, "Yes, I would have said so much more." But every time I started to formulate what I wanted to express, because English is not my first language, the conversation would go too fast. I do feel like there are an awful lot of projects, whether or not a kind of a bicultural issue is at play or other issues are at play, that we're finding ourselves rubbing up against this constant pressure with how these kinds of projects and who the people are that transform them and transform us as members of the art community. I think there's still a lot to figure out.
Yeah, I think this is important. Actually, I want to ask Eve if she can comment on this. The whole question of the public, we're kind of shifting into a question of audience and public and engagement and who we are actually engaging. I think in the first panel, there was a lot of discussion about engaging other photographers, engaging other artists, starting to engage a community around certain works of art and the wide range of possibilities for works of art. Eve, you're having people come in which are, from the bar, from the neighborhood, completely off the street. Can you talk about what you see the power of the public here? And I'm sure others up here have something to say about that, but you seem to be directly on the front line of that.
Well, I see our public to be very particularly an art community public. It's like the artists who we're showing, and it's other people that are, it's like primarily artists. And what I think is really interesting is that they're bringing them into the part of town we're in is what, like, it's a lot of other people do come in through our doors and experience our openings and events, but also the fact that we're bringing all of those artists, it's like we're not on a row with many other galleries, and we're not in a neighborhood that people would be in otherwise, so we know that everyone that comes to our shows has come kind of as the destination, and then we're creating this whole experience for them, and our openings tend to go really long, and we bring that bar business, and we bring the taco stand outside business, and we bring, the pizza place across the street business, and bringing people there I think is really great. And then the smaller moments when it's like the street people that are coming in, but they get really excited to see this stuff because they don't care so much that they don't know how to talk about it. It's like activity that's really exciting, just happening like on a otherwise no man's land kind of street at night.
And can you talk about it, because I'm sure this is happening on the bus continually.
So the bus, we've been surveying the riders before we started and afterwards, and one of our questions is, do you see art on the bus? And exactly half the people say yes, and half the people say no, about the same environment. And they... so we say, well, what kind of art do you see on the bus? And 3% say they see other people that are art, that what they're wearing or the notebook that has the art item that they consider is what the art they see. They all look at me and say, "Do you think graffiti's art?" Like, all of them, and they're just reading my face to figure out whether I'm one of those people that thinks that or not, because it's a yes-no question. And the other thing is 90% said they like art. They all were very vague, though, on whether advertising art, poetry on the posters, all the graffiti, you know, actually the pay white upholstery that's in the buses, that all of that, everything that's visual is sort of one big vague thing that's visual, and they don't know whether to call it art or not.
Edgar, I know you've bumped up against some issues with the public, with the neighborhood. How have you tried to not only frame this, but also, you know, bring, you talk about bringing a community and creating this kind of situation. How has this played out for you beyond, you know, the ability to transform house by house? I mean, what's the larger context that you think you're creating?
I mean, the question of audience is one that,
I mean, the question of audience is one that each practitioner has to weigh if it's even one worth engaging in. It is, for us, I mean, to talk about audience in that particular way is really more about representation and how we sort of replay what it is that we do to someone else. And that's where the sort of the audience thing sort of becomes a question, which is entirely not very useful for us, just primarily because we don't really make anything. So when we try to represent it to other people, it never really quite gets there. So, you know, part of the thing for us is just to try to talk about it as eloquently as we can, to express the poetics in the best that you can, without falling into the cliches and metaphors that oftentimes working within the public sphere can do, and try to get as many people as you can to experience it directly. As far as us sort of thinking about who are the artists and whom are we engaging with, I think that what we try to do is to fundamentally just jump over that entire question altogether. I think that it plagues art students to no end. And just simply what we're trying to do through a creative process is to change the roles that people play in the shaping of their space. We're not trying to be like Alan Caprow and say everybody is an artist, because the difference between artists and everybody else is that artists make art. So if we just simply give people tools in which they can think about themselves differently, then they will probably, in most instances, act differently too.
Mark, do you want to add something, or will, as we're talking about audiences, let's open it up to the audience. Where is Vanessa to help with a microphone?
Anne, I wanted to ask you a question. You said that you ask the writers if they like art, and what percentage of them say they like art?
91.
Do you also ask them if they like artists?
No.
12.
No.
What was the answer? Did she say no?
No. Oh.
Okay.
I have actually kind of a difficult question for Evie, but all of you can speak to this. I have a few friends who are also doing things downtown, like multi-purpose kind of spaces. But I'm wondering, what are your thoughts on the gentrification of downtown and how that's changing the urban landscape, and how maybe that all of these really trendy, interesting art spaces that are happening downtown, that kids are starting, you know, out of art school or, you know, in their early and mid-20s, how those types of spaces might actually be, you know, raising rent prices downtown and changing the landscape, basically.
Well, where we're located is basically the spaces that I'm in and are around us are sweatshops. It's like industry. We're not displacing anybody's home. Activity coming to that area is only bringing people into the city that, you know, are in other areas throughout Los Angeles. There's huge developers are buying buildings and making like soft lofts and condos, and like that's the thing that's doing it. We are like, yeah, like you're saying, out of school, I don't have any money. I find the cheapest like space that I think that I can creatively repurpose to provide a context for a different kind of art scene. And you know, I can't afford to go be in a gallery district or something, and maybe I don't want to be a part of somebody else's group of art galleries anyway. So, yeah, the fact that nobody's living in any of these spaces, it's industry, it's sweatshops, it's, like, not really good. There's not good activity happening there anyways. And again, like I said, we're bringing like the taco stand that's next door, that has been next door always, we're bringing them like so much business and like providing, you know, that kind of support to that area. And yeah, I don't think that what we do contributes to the bad things that I like am right there with you on that are happening in different parts of the city.
You make a good politician. They always talk about the job creation stuff to Jen too. Their actions. I mean, not a politician, but you'll make a good public sort of speaker. You can speak to it. These are genuine compliments.
I'm sure this question comes up for you.
Oh yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, it's not a fair question. I mean, you know, the truth is that it's not a fair question. It's not a fair question because the truth is that the reason why she's there is the same reason that the sweatshops are there, because it's cheap. You see,
I lived in that space for a year and a half before we even ran the gallery, and like the biggest response, it's like the white girl in the middle of this like dangerous part of town, and like I think that like it's far more interesting to be integrated in a like new way rather than keeping everything really separate. Like this is much more engaging to not be like, oh, we can't touch this area of town because it's supposed to be this, and that like the moment you walk into it, it's like this word gentrification, but that's actually not what's happening. It's like really interesting like things happening.
And gentrification is not a bad thing. Honestly, it is not. I mean, if you move into a neighborhood, you purchase a home, and the property value goes up 50%, good for you.
People get displaced.
But like, for the people who make the investment into a space using their sweat equity, using whatever dollars that they put into it, and then other developers come in and take advantage of that and they get displaced, that's what's bad about it. Now, the truth is that if the law was set up in a way in which, you know, you came into this neighborhood, you invested $50,000 worth of time and energy, and your landlord say, hey, I'm doubling the rent, you gotta get out, you'd be like, peace, as long as I get my $50,000. And then you go in and then you go and buy something for yourself. But the truth is that never really happens. And most of the time it's because artists don't either have the idea to even try to purchase the spaces that they're in, or they don't find it as a moral value that they want to advocate for. So artists actually rank, I think, sixth in the nation of income disparities between the haves and the have-nots. Between, you know, the Damien Hirst of the world and my mentors, who tend to be people whom can't even afford to have health insurance or pay their rent sometimes, right? The income disparity is huge. So we find ourselves in this very strange location where we have these great amount of skills, we got a shitload of debt, and we're like, well, where can we go? We go move in next to the sweatshop. And then we get a bad rap of gentrification, you know? But it's, you know, but you should try to buy that place, is what I'm saying. Raise some money, buy the building, and when, you know, then you can benefit and you can help a lot more people that way.
Edgar's been telling me that for 10 years.
I've been telling you to buy that building, man. I'm telling you, you gotta buy that building.
Hi, thanks. I had a few questions. Well, first of all, I appreciate that conversation about gentrification, and it's an importance. I agree with you. I mean, I think it's an important idea, and it's an important thing to think about, but I think we can move beyond that conversation a little bit and think about the positives of what we are doing by moving into those spaces. I had a question about not all of you have to answer, whatever, but about collectivity and the hierarchy and the infrastructures that you guys have created. Those are things that I deal with in the artist-run space that I've spent the last 6 months dealing with, and I'd just be interested in your experience of that. What does collectivity mean to you? Do you think about that when you're creating that? How many people do you collaborate, not collaborate in terms of the artists that you bring into or invite into or allow into your space to participate, but rather the people you, who makes those decisions? And how does that work? And what does that infrastructure look like? And is there a hierarchy? You guys being the executive directors, do you form the hierarchy of that space? How does that work with your collaborators? Those kinds of things. Thanks.
And can you tell us what your space is?
Oh, yeah, Concord Space. Okay. Yeah, thanks.
Can I start? Because I think mine is the weirdest. And Edgar's teasing me about my latest word for trying to describe it, which is confederacy. And the reason I picked like the world's most awkward word for joining a bunch of people together is I've been trying to find a way to articulate a bunch of people working together with equitable but unequal and constantly shifting power structure. So, and what I've done is I've really tried to look at, there's vertical forms of organizing, which are corporate, right? Like you have distribution of power, this guy makes the widgets, this guy sells the widgets, this lady runs the whole business, this lady invested all the money in it. And there are efficiencies in verticality. I've also looked at a lot of horizontal models, which have a lot of utility to them. And personally, I've tried to combine them. And I figured out that for a lot of artists, it's really useful to have somebody else whose job is to like say no to things and to raise money and to kind of do those horrible things, right?
Sorry.
But there's also ways in which you can work in which transfers of ideas horizontally can be really powerful. So just in my own organization, I started it, I'm the director, but there's probably 20 or 30 artists that I've worked with for 10 years now, and the ideas of what happened transfer between those. And the way I try and deal with it from a cultural capital perspective is when we're talking about the big project, I'm sitting up here, but when the show's happening at the gallery, like we have this incredible installation now by Nate Page, it's not like Nate Page plus Mark Allen because he contributed some ideas, it's like it's Nate Page's project, and we kind of move the press through that way. So I think negotiating collectivity is something that a ton of artists are thinking about now, and it's something you kind of just feel your way into something that works. And you can tell if it doesn't work because everybody's mad at you, and then all of a sudden you're not working together anymore.
You know it's not working when the joy is gone.
Yeah, if it's not fun, maybe you should find another model.
And I just think we're having this conversation in the middle of Occupy LA, Occupy Wall Street. Well, Occupy is sort of the background that is, that model is causing a huge shift. And to me, the historic art world is a very hierarchical system. And that we're talking about is this transformation, not one or the other, but a transformation.
You know, my face is constantly like rubberizing because there are so many things about what everybody's saying that I'm deeply engaged in thinking about. This project that we just concluded with Suzanne Lacy was outlined very much what Mark was talking about. We used a more a horizontal organizing pattern. Although what else was really quite interesting was how clear Suzanne was as the lead artist that she was going to take a lead on shaping the vision and the image of the project as a whole. Which, it's not quite the same as what you were saying about being the person to say no or raise the money, but I do think that there is a certain kind of clarity and leadership that has allowed certain projects and practices to be able to be seen in a lot of different really productive ways because you are negotiating these relationships and recognizing that they are unequal, that it's not about a super horizontal sort of path.
I'm gonna send it back out to the audience in 1 second. I'm just wondering your opinions on how much you think of this is driven by being here in LA, and how much you think our landscape here contributes to the potential
potential for these different shapes of practices, which are based on not just public engagement, but a collective stance?
I would say FreeWaves is completely dependent on this being a Los Angeles background. That was really, that was all the advertising all over the street is what pissed me off so bad that I haven't recovered yet and I'm still, you know, counterattacking it. The other is that of really the geographic distribution is so enormous. So if you're at 7th and LA Street, that's just a dot in the whole mega system. It's so enormous here, and really trying to do things that interact with the city on a larger scale, and it's so enormous, and it's that keep coming up with different strategies, it seems like an obvious, you know, method.
You know, your one's financial architecture has a direct effect upon your organizational structure. So being in LA means that your money's going to come to you in a certain way, and which is different if you were in Seattle or Portland or Houston or in New York. LA is a city of agglomeration as opposed to a sort of a large-scale economy which is centralized. So your money is probably nodal too. And if you have one person in your group or your board who's dropping all the money, then, you know, I mean, things are probably going to lean in the direction that's going to keep that people, that person happy. If you got 1,500 people that you're getting money from, that means that you're going to structure yourself a little bit differently.
So you think it's better to not get any money?
I think that it really depends upon the temperament of the person who's running the thing, and that it needs to make sense in relationship to you as its leader.
This is William, who co-runs Control Room.
Oh. Good work, William.
Yeah, hi. I have sort of a weird question, and I'm going to make a division between two things that there's certainly plenty of overlap about, but do any of you find yourselves coming down on one side or the other about which is most important, building a community and creating something for people in like a network, or art? And interesting art that sometimes has nothing to do with that, and often they can get in the way of each other. And sometimes, you know, especially as an organization grows or whatever, it can keep expanding. And then so much time is put into making sure that that community stays tight, and then programming can be diluted. And but also, you know, sometimes creating that community, you know, can be thought of as an artwork. So I know that's kind of a division I'm making between the two, but where do any of you kind of fall on one side or the other?
Should make you answer the question. Then why are those two things opposite to each other?
They're not. I think that sometimes,
you oppose
each other. It's like a framing, right?
It's like some 20th century shit. You know?
I think there's something interesting about that framing.
Mark, can you?
Well, I mean, I think at the core there's something interesting about that framing because, as well, from various degrees, being 501c3s, public charities or not, I think there's always, I mean, let's just look at the standard questions you get. It's like, how are you actually connecting to your community? So we got a version of that question during this panel. Are you causing gentrification? Are you damaging your community? We got a version of that question in the panel. So there's always that question, whether you want to play with that framing or not, that's going to come to you. And I think what you point out in your question is that becomes the most interesting when your practice can address it in some kind of meta fashion. So that the construction of your audience or how your audience is relating to content is part of how you're thinking of doing your work, for the reasons that your work are interesting, rather than some kind of obligatory sense of like, oh, I live in a neighborhood that's like 35% Mac users, I better have 35% content for Mac, but I can't neglect all those PC users because they're this real integral core of my neighborhood. So I think that the more that you can bring it in directly to what you're doing, the more interesting that becomes and the less you get annoyed when people ask you that panel discussion. So I think that's why you'll notice Edgar's not annoyed ever by these kind of questions, because his project
has that at the core of it, and he gets to kind of work with it.
And also just wanted to point out that all of your metaphors are directly related to your programming. Comments, PCs versus Macs. You know, I just wanted, just so you guys can keep track of it throughout the day. But it is an extension of your personality.
Yeah, we can only see the world through the lenses of which we choose to hold up in front of our face, right?
It just goes to show that you really believe in the things that you
do.
And
thank
you,
Edgar.
And then there's a question over here, I think. Yeah. Okay. And
what I feel like how I handle that question is that before I put out a new event or I put out an open call, and what I try to do is totally define every aspect of what is going to happen. I'm going to have 50 stores, they're going to be, you know, taco stands, and I'm looking for, the title's going to be Hollywood, and I'm going to pay, and I need it by this date. And then just open call. And then, so inviting artists that want that situation to use it, and all the others that don't want that situation to let it be.
There's a question right back here. Right there? Yeah.
A more kind of general question, you know, which of your organizations have boards, which don't? Why? You know, if you don't have a board structure, if you don't deal with a board, you know, was that a choice? Was that, you know, how did you kind of come to make that decision? Did it just sort of happen organically?
Well, some of them are 501c3s, which require a board. So who has a 501c3? Okay, so those require by the federal government to get 501c3s, not-for-profit status, you are required to have a board of directors.
And so we choose to not have to... Having a board is just going to be impose a structure upon how an organization is run that we didn't feel would be productive for how we wanted to run our space. And so because we're both grad students and have jobs often and like are doing this space as we can because we want to, only just because we care and are not getting money from anyone, most of the work goes into making the projects just happen. And sometimes the projects happen at the last minute, and we do the best promotion that we can with the time that we have. But imposing another kind of anything that takes up time that out of that is really difficult, because that's just a more structure to work with, and then it's somebody else to report to, and it's more heads in the room, and we just like working really directly with the artists, and whether we are curating a show or they've proposed the show, and just making it happen however it's possible to make happen. And that means all our money is out of pocket, but I think that that's what has generated the energy that our shows have generated.
Sorry, you follow up.
I don't know if there's any way to discuss it here, but you know, if the other four, what are the similarities and differences between your relationships with your various boards?
Well, that's probably a whole other long conversation. But you know, let me take it from what you said to another field, just to sort of give it some agency as to how one organizes itself, how it has a real direct effect upon if what you're being driven by is some sort of purpose, or you have some kind of mission-driven activity. So if there was an interview that I'd heard on This American Life, and it was about a doctor, an American doctor who was working in Haiti. This was before the quake. And one of the things that he said was, when he first got there, he went to one of the top medical schools, and it was completely disorganized. The doctors weren't totally equipped to be able to deal with the immensity of the health issues that they were facing. And how he approached it in the beginning was, you know what, I have all the answers, I know what to do, and I'm just going to do it. And he tried that, but pretty quickly he realized that there were inherent limitations to that, at least in regards to the immensity of the problem, because he wasn't building capacity for any of the other doctors that were around him. So basically, when he left, everything left with him, right? So what he decided was, I'm going to slow down, and I'm going to build capacity for the other doctors,
And that sounds really great and rosy, and that sounds like a wonderful thing. But what he said was that the reality is that if he does that, that means that in the process, there's less people that he'll be able to help, and that means that some people are going to die. Right? So, like, the way in which we organize ourselves has a direct proportional effect upon the missions that we do. And in this instance, your ability to be flexible and nimble and all that stuff, those are wonderful qualities and the thing that makes it vibrant for what you do. When we take that same conversation to other contexts, then it really talks about what's really circumstantially important about really weighing these decisions wisely.
I think Carol has the final say.
Okay. Right, I actually wanted to loop back to a question that you had actually asked a couple of rounds back, which is how does operating in Los Angeles either shape or, you know, create a unique circumstance, or how can we link it to this region, this place? And, you know, that's something that I think the uniqueness that I see continuing to surface is the urban condition that Anne has spoken about really eloquently and really motivates a lot of inspiration. There's also a level of density, not only in practitioners and projects, as well as an interest in the public dialogue of understanding what we are doing. That is unique. So I don't know that the actual practices and the manner with which we do is unique. I think you can go to a lot of different places around the country and around the globe. But let's stick with the states for just a microsecond. I think we have an interest in surfacing and framing what we are doing because of the programs and the practitioners and a certain kind of collegiality that, mm-hmm. you know, we've all referenced. And I think that's one thing that's really important. And then the final word, which is I've often used in other circumstances, as a part of interviewing artists for Pacific Standard Time around performance, Nancy Buchanan spoke about her relationship to performance. And in particular, how at a certain point, the direction that it seemed to be going for her, but also the expectations of the audience and the community, she found unuseful. And so at a certain point, she decided that was no longer a form that she was going to use to seek out creating work. But she is still certainly a well-respected and important artist, you know, in our community and within the canon. And that's one thing I'll be really interested to see as we reflect back on this time is, you know, what ultimately happened? How far did we take these forms? How long were they still useful? And when did we make decisions to move in a different direction, but still maintain our commitment to making art, being artists? That's what I think.
Thank you. I'd just like to thank everyone. This has been an incredible day about LA, about artists, about creativity, about collectivity. And I really want to thank Selma and the Fisher Museum for hosting us here. I would like to thank everyone from the first panel, everyone now. And my understanding is that there is a reception in the courtyard right by the Fisher Museum, and everyone can continue the dialogue there. So thank you for coming.